right, boys and girls, I'm very excited to be here with you today for another brand new lesson. And this one's on the plagues of Egypt and what we can learn from that. So let's get started. So the theme of today's lesson is God's judgment on unrepentant sin. There's a difference between a true believer of God and an unrepentant or backslidden person like Pharaoh. And we see this with the 10 plagues God did in Egypt in Exodus chapters 7 through 12. In these chapters, we can learn a lot about God, the difference between God's power, which is unlimited, that means he can do anything, and Satan's power, which is limited, and that means he can only do so much. The difference between a people who obey and the people who do not obey, and the difference between true repentance and counterfeit or fake repentance. God is merciful and forgiving to those who have chosen to turn from sin and who have asked Jesus to forgive them of their sins, to those who love God, and to those who obey the gospel of Jesus Christ. So I kind of mentioned this on the theme slide. What I'm going to be doing is a comparison between God's power and Satan's power, and also a comparison between God's people, an obedient people, and Pharaoh's people, a disobedient people. And rather than reading chapters 7 through 12 out of Exodus, which would take a really long time, I put them into two nice charts for you to make it go quicker. So why did God send the plagues into Egypt? God sent Moses to tell Pharaoh to let his people go. And you might remember from lesson 15, I Am, where God met him at the burning bush and told him, hey, I'm going to use you. I'm going to send you to Pharaoh, and you're going to tell him, let my people go. And we're going to find out that he wouldn't let them go. So God sent the 10 plagues into Egypt as a judgment for Pharaoh and his people's disobedience to what God told them to do. There's a lot of important things we're going to learn today about God here from these passages. So on this first chart, we see God's capabilities versus the devil's in these plagues. And in the first column, we have the plague number and what the plague was. And it goes numbers 1 through 10. And then before number 1, you also see a column where I have before the plagues. And that's Moses' staff or walking stick being turned into a snake. And I also want to include that because it's kind of a show and tell of what God was about to do here with these plagues that, hey, I can do this. I'm all powerful. I can do anything. So you see that God was able to do that in Exodus 7:10. Well, the devil was also able to counterfeit that. So his magicians threw down their staffs and they turned into snakes. But God's snake ate all of theirs. So he was saying, hey, yeah, the devil can do that, but I am bigger and greater than him. I can do anything. And we see in the first plague, water turned into blood. Yep, God was able to do it. And the devil also, through his magicians, he could do that too. The same thing with the frogs. Yep, God could do it. And the devil could also counterfeit that in Exodus 8:7. And then we see something a little bit different here with number 3, these gnats, or what the King James says is lice. So it says when the magicians couldn't replicate God's plague, number 3, the gnats, then the magician said to Pharaoh, this is the finger of God. And that's in Exodus 8:19a. And I kind of wonder what was different about the gnats that the devil couldn't counterfeit that one. Now, he could do frogs, he could turn water into blood, but he could not do these gnats. Kind of a curious thing, but ultimately, God is all-powerful, and the devil's power is limited. Now, in the second grid, I have how these plagues impacted the people of God versus the people of Pharaoh. And the people of God being the obedient people, and the people of Pharaoh being the disobedient. Now, you have in the first row, again, the plague number and what the plague was from 1 to 10. I do not have the show and tell part here with Moses' staff being turned into a snake, because that was really more just to show what God's power was versus Satan's. So you see with the first plague, water turned into blood, it says that this did happen in Egypt, but it didn't say whether or not it happened in Goshen. but you do see for certain that the water was turned into blood in Egypt for Pharaoh's people. And likewise, plague number two, the frogs, it says that there was frogs in Egypt, but it didn't say whether or not there was frogs in Goshen. But it was certain that there were frogs in Egypt. Likewise, the gnats, it said they were in Egypt. It did not say whether or not they were in Goshen, but it was certain they were in Egypt. But it does specify with plague number four that there's a difference. So God made it a point when he did plague number four, the flies, to say, "And I will sever or make a separation in that day the land of Goshen," and that separation being from the land of Egypt, "and that land of Goshen in which my people dwell, the people of Israel, that no swarms of flies may be there, to the end that you know that I am the Lord in the midst of the earth." And that's Exodus 8:22. So he's saying there's going to be flies in Egypt. There are not going to be flies in Goshen. So there was a difference between the people of God and Pharaoh's people. And you see that as we move forward with plague number five, where all the livestock or their farm animals die. There was no livestock, not even one, that died in Goshen, but all of them died in Egypt. And with number six, which was the boils or blisters on your skin, there was no boils, not any, on the skin of the people of Israel, which were in Goshen, but there was boils on the skin of the people in Egypt. And it even said there was boils on the magicians, so they couldn't make it go away. So that was pretty serious there. And number seven, with hail and fire, there was no hail and fire in Goshen, but there was hail and fire in Egypt. And with plague number eight, now this is locusts. So the reason that's so bad, so locusts are like giant grasshoppers. What they do is when there's a big swarm of them, they just come in and mow down the whole farm. There's no greenery, nothing, no food. All of the grain is just eaten down to nothing. And it says that this was in Egypt. It did not say whether or not it happened in Goshen. And I don't really think it made that much of a difference anyway, even if the grasshoppers did mow everything down in Goshen, because they were going to be out of there here pretty soon anyway. God was going to deliver them out of that land. But regardless, there were still locusts in Egypt. Now, with number nine, the darkness that could be felt, it says that there were lights in the dwellings in Goshen, but there was darkness in Egypt. And this lasted for 3 days. And it wasn't just darkness where you couldn't see nothing. It was darkness that could be felt. So there was, I think, a spiritual darkness that was there too. Ugh. So it was scary. And number 10, the death of the firstborn. Now, this is known as the Passover. So what the Israelites had to do, the people of Goshen, was to kill a lamb and spread its blood over the doorpost. And the death angel would pass over that house, and the firstborn child in that house or person would live. Now, that's a picture of what Jesus did on the cross. So he is the Lamb of God. He was slain from the foundation of the world for our sins. He paid for our sins when he died on the cross for us, and his blood was shed. Now, the people of Egypt were not covered by the blood of the Lamb. So that would be a picture of somebody who rejects Jesus, an unrepentant person or a backslidden person that totally walks away from the Lord. That is a picture of Egypt here. So the death of the firstborn, all of their firstborn, they ended up dying in Egypt, but not one person died in Goshen. So a huge difference between the two here. And now we're going to see what counterfeit repentance or fake repentance is. And we're going to see how Pharaoh continued an unrepentant sin. He did not turn from his sin, and what the consequence of that was. So first we're going to see after God sent plague number two, the frogs, in Exodus 8:8. "Then Pharaoh called for Moses and Aaron and said, 'Entreat the Lord that he may take away the frogs from me and from my people, and I will let the people go, that they may do sacrifice unto the Lord.'" So Moses went and talked to God. He said, "Hey, Pharaoh's saying, can we take the frogs away? Okay, we'll take the frogs away. Did Pharaoh let the people go?
Nope.
Pharaoh disobeyed God. He sinned and would not let the people go. And in our second example here, after God sent plague number 4, the flies, and this is Exodus 8, 28 through 29. And Pharaoh said, I will let you go, that you may sacrifice to the Lord your God in the wilderness. Only you shall not go very far away. Entreat for me. And Moses said, behold, I go out from you, and I will entreat the Lord that the swarms of flies may depart from Pharaoh, and from his servants, and from his people tomorrow. But let not Pharaoh deal deceitfully any more in not letting the people go to sacrifice to the Lord. So Moses went and talked to God, said, hey, can we take the flies away? Okay, we can take the flies away. Did Pharaoh let the people go?
Nope.
Pharaoh disobeyed God. He sinned and would not let the people go. And in our third example here, we have after God sent plague number 7, hail and fire. And this is Exodus chapter 9, verses 27 and 28. And Pharaoh sent and called for Moses and Aaron and said unto them, I have sinned this time. The Lord is righteous, and my people are wicked. So we even have a confession here of, oh, I've sinned against God. And he's saying to Moses, entreat the Lord, for it is enough, that there should be no more mighty thunderings and hail. And I will let you go, and you shall stay no longer. So, again, Moses went, he talked to God, can we take the hail and the fire away? Okay. Did Pharaoh let the people go?
Nope.
Pharaoh disobeyed God again. He sinned and he would not let the people go. All right. Now in our fourth example here, we see after God sent plague number 8, the locust that mowed everything down in Exodus 10 verses 16 and 17. Then Pharaoh called for Moses and Aaron in haste. In other words, quickly, he went and got them and said, I have sinned against your God and against you. So again, we have a confession of sin. I've sinned. Now, therefore, forgive, I pray thee, my sin only this once, and entreat the Lord your God that he may take away from me this death only. So Moses went, talked to God. Can we take the swarms of locusts away that are devouring everything? Okay, we can take the locusts away. Did Pharaoh let the people go?
Nope.
Pharaoh disobeyed God. He sinned and would not let the people go. And lastly, we have plague number 9, a darkness that could be felt. And it says, and Pharaoh called unto Moses and said, go ye, serve the Lord, only let your flocks and your herds be stayed. So leave the animals behind, but let your little ones, in other words, your kids, also go with you. And note, Pharaoh tried to put stipulations or restrictions on it. And Moses said, you must also give us sacrifice and burnt offerings, that we may sacrifice unto the Lord our God. Our cattle also shall go with us. There shall not be one hoof left behind, for thereof we must take to serve the Lord our God. And we know not with what we must serve the Lord until we come thither. So we don't know what we're going to need to sacrifice to God until we go there. So you got to let us take it all with us. Even after this, did Pharaoh let the people go?
Nope.
Pharaoh disobeyed God again. And he sinned and would not let the people go. So up until this point, Pharaoh was warned every time before all of the plagues what God was going to do and what God expected Pharaoh to do to let the people go. So he warned them each time. So now we're going to see, again, after God sent plague number 9, a darkness that could be felt. This is continuing in verses 27 through 29 out of Exodus 10. It says, but the Lord hardened Pharaoh's heart, and he would not let the people go. And Pharaoh said unto him, Get away from me. Take heed to yourself. See my face no more. For in the day that you see my face, you shall surely die. And Moses said, And you have spoken well. I will see your face again no more. And he didn't. And now the grand finale, the end result of Pharaoh's continued disobedience. So God sent the last plague, plague number 10, and all the firstborn of the Egyptians died. But the people of Israel were covered by the blood of the Passover lamb that was killed for them. And this is a picture of what Jesus did for us on the cross. Jesus was the lamb that was slain from the foundation of the world to take away our sins. So Jesus paid for our sins by his own blood shed for us on the cross. And Pharaoh finally let the people go. But while they were on their way, Pharaoh and his army chased after them. And God parted the Red Sea for the Israelites and set them free. But Pharaoh and his army drowned in the Red Sea. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Romans 6:23. So eventually, Pharaoh's unrepentant sin led to his death, and ultimately eternal punishment of God's wrath forever and ever. Yikes, that is scary. And now about counterfeit repentance, or fake repentance. So we saw in these examples with Pharaoh how God would warn him, Hey, I told you, let my people go. If you don't, I'm going to send this plague. So Pharaoh wouldn't let the people go. God would send the plague. And then Pharaoh would be like, Oh, please take it away. This is bad. And I'll let your people go. So God takes the plague away. He doesn't let the people go. Same principle applies to us. So we are not to do what Pharaoh did. Repentance is not just feeling bad or telling Jesus, I repent, and then we keep going back and doing the same thing over and over again like Pharaoh did, or giving God lip service to make the consequences of it go away just long enough so we can get back into doing what we want to do. So that is not what repentance is about. Even a criminal feels bad when he stands before the judge and receives the sentence. But he didn't feel bad because he did the wrong thing or disobeyed God. He felt bad because he got caught and there was consequences. And that's why the Bible says there will be weeping and wailing and gnashing of teeth when unrepentant or backslidden people stand before the judgment seat of God. And now, the good side of things, true repentance. True repentance involves a change in attitude about our sin, and ultimately a change in direction towards obedience in Christ Jesus. We choose to turn from our sin and turn to Jesus, and ask Jesus to help us not to continue to do what displeases him. And he promises us a new heart and a new mind when we come to him and ask him for it. Because of our sinful nature, we have to be aware of our own thoughts and how those are trying to lead us into sin, and how we, even in our minds, we try to justify our actions that we know are wrong, and even dismiss the ones that are true, or squelch the Holy Spirit when he's trying to tell us, Hey, yeah, I really don't want you doing that. That's not the right thing to do. And we try to squelch those voices so that we can ultimately do what we want to do. And it doesn't work that way. So we're to take those thoughts captive to the obedience of Christ. And we see that in 2 Corinthians 10:5. And it's super important we spend lots of time with Jesus in prayer and ask Jesus to help us to see those things that he wants us to do differently. And when he shows us, that we ask him to help us to not continue to do those things, and he will. We all need God's help. Lessons like this help us to understand truth from error and right from wrong, the things that make God happy, and the things that we need to ask for Jesus' help with. It's important to talk to God every day in prayer and to ask him to help us to know what things to pray for and to help us to be more and more like Him. And part of that is recognizing when there's things that we're doing that are wrong or we know that are mean and hurtful to other people, like hitting people or taking their toys or back-talking mom and dad, not doing what they ask us to do. And when we do that, we're not loving another person. So we need to ask Jesus to forgive us and to help us to not keep doing those things and to help us to love people like He does. The Bible says, "Let us therefore come boldly unto the throne of grace." In other words, we never have to be afraid to come to Jesus when we need His help, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. Hebrews 4:6. And it's important to spend time every day reading your Bible and ask mom or dad or grandma or grandpa or good friend to help you to read and to understand it. Jesus loves you so very much, and you're His kid, and you're somebody very, very special to Him. And I want to thank you so much for being here with me for lesson 16, and I'll look forward to seeing you for lesson 17. Love you guys, and God bless. Bye.